got it all, but I feel so deprived. I go up, I come down, and I'm emptier inside. Tell me, what is this thing that I feel like I'm missing, and why can't I let it go? There's gotta be more to life than chasing out every temporary hurt to satisfy me. 'Cause the more that I'm tripping out thinking there must be more to life, well, there's life, but I'm sure. Got the time, and I'm wasting it slowly. Here in this moment, I'm halfway out the door, onto the next thing that's searching for something that's missing. There's gotta be more to life than chasing out every temporary hurt to satisfy me. 'Cause the more that I'm tripping out,
in the life, well, not the best month, but it's a really good month in the life of the church. Does anybody know why? It's stewardship season. It is, right? October is always stewardship season in the life of the church, and so welcome everybody. I get to be Steve Melde, your pastor, and it's good to be with you this morning. Vision 2020 is the theme of our 2020 annual stewardship campaign, and we begin a process of understanding what we're about and what we're going to be about next year and how we all support that ministry. So each Sunday in worship, you'll see some skits. What we're doing this year through the stewardship team is kind of digging back in our history and looking back through the history of the church on how others were involved in the life of the church and how they supported the life and ministry of the church that we get to enjoy now and how we get to support it so others in the future get to enjoy it as well. So welcome to Vision 2020. Doug, let's jump right into nominating team has a special message for us today. So let's go on the handheld, Jordan.
Good morning. For those of you who don't know, I'm Doug Thompson, and today I'm before you representing the nominating committee. First off, I would like to thank those who prayerfully said yes, and also to those who prayerfully said no. Today has been a really smooth transition, but we are in need of one position, and that's called the vision for our, we are looking for people with a vision for our church. We all know society is changing and church attendance is declining. The big question is, how do we make CPC effective and relevant now and in the future, bringing people to Christ? We need a vision team chair, and people on that team who believe that God has high expectations for our church and a vital future. We need people who believe that our program should be part of our ministry and the vision of CPC. And finally, we need people who understand that we must develop a plan that will sustain CPC into the future. Are you a visionary? Would you be interested in leading or serving on this team, or do you know someone who would? If so, please see me after the service or contact me. And if you sign up today, you get to wear these for the first year of our 2020 vision. Thank you very much.
There's nothing boring about being a leader in this church. Many of you know that we are coming alongside the Catholic Community Services in a program called Casa Salitas that is helping asylum-seeking immigrants here in our country. Today is the first Sunday of the week or of the month, and so in the first week, our intention is to help with overflow folks when Casa Alitas is too full with immigrants and they need churches to take some folks to help them get to their sponsors. We've agreed to do so. Right now, the numbers crossing are very low, and so Casa Alitas is able to handle everybody at their main center. We had planned to host this week. For those of you who signed up, thank you very much. But we will not be a host site this week. We just spoke to them yesterday. They only have one family there right now. So if you are still interested in this program and you don't want to wait for just the first week of the month when we're hosting here on our campus, what I encourage you to do is a web search for Casa Alitas Tucson. Up will come the Catholic Community Services page. Follow through in its links. They have a training program that you can get connected to, and then you can go down to what is the Juvenile Detention Center, and they have developed an entire wing of the old Juvie Center into this beautiful welcoming center for these asylum-seeking immigrants. Remember, these are folks who have crossed legally and have been entered into the asylum program legally and simply need help getting to their sponsor and their sponsor's family. So they're usually here a day or two, a night or two, and their sponsors send bus tickets or airline tickets. We just house them, feed them, clothe them until we can get them onto the transportation and to their families. So if this is something you're interested in participating, it does go on every day of the month. There are other churches that take on different weeks of the month as overflow programs. So if you're not able to help in the first week of the month, or if we're not needed and they still need folks down at the main center, just do a web search for Casa Alitas Tucson and get yourself hooked up, get trained. You're going to get a badge then that allows you access to the building and access to be a volunteer at any time. So I hope that you'll take time to do that. I think those are all the announcements that we have today. Let's get ourselves ready for worship. I invite you to take this opening moment to be in prayer on your own, to center yourself in God's Spirit that's already here with us. Let's pray. Some have done some counting, and it appears that at least 365 times in the Bible, it says some form of fear not, which means every day of our lives, God, through God's Holy Spirit, is telling us to stop being afraid. And yet we still are, aren't we? Sometimes life is overwhelming and difficult, but we come to worship to center ourselves on the light of God in Jesus Christ. And to be reminded that whatever it is we face it with the presence of God in Jesus Christ. We don't have to be afraid, but in our fear is the presence of the one who will lead us. Come this morning. Let's rise and give God our praise. job. You all may be seated. Let's join together in prayer. Our dear and precious God, are you serious? Don't be afraid. When every day there are things to be scared of. Thank you. Thank you for the reminder that you're with us. And when you are with us in this life, we can set aside the fear and face whatever it is we have in our lives to face, simply with the confidence of your presence. You are the creator of the universe. You know how everything works. You know how everything came to be. You know how everything's going to turn out. To whom else would we turn? And yet we turn to all sorts of others. And we still find ourselves afraid. So we come here, God, to turn our lives over to you again. To reclaim our trust in you through your Holy Spirit. And to know that whatever comes our way, you'll see us through. Thank you for all the successes we've had in our lives. Thank you for being with us in our failures. Thank you for forgiving us. Help us, oh God, to be more faithful and to show the world your incredible grace that we know of in Jesus Christ. Because we know in his life, in his death, in his resurrection, you do forgive us, and we're grateful for that. So thank you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Is this on? Okay, thank you. My name is Linda Tillema, and I am the chair, elder chair of stewardship and finance. My cool glasses are gold, but I can't see out of them. So. In our planning for the campaign for October, we, of course, obviously went to Vision 2020. But we also wanted to look at the past. What has made us who we are? Presbyterianism actually is based on the teachings of John Calvin during the Reformation of the mid-1500s. One of his students, an ex-Catholic priest named John Knox, studied with him in Geneva, Switzerland, and then returned to Scotland and brought those teachings with him and started the Scottish Reformation in 1560. As the movement grew, it was in conflict, of course, with the Church of England, but opportunities came up for immigration to this new world, someplace across the Atlantic, and a voyage of months. There's evidence that Presbyterians were at Jamestown, but the first organized church was in 1640 in what is now Southampton, Long Island, New York. I have with me today one of the representatives from that 1640 church. Her name is Goodwife Sarah Smith. Please come out. Greetings.
This is a really curious space. Why are your curtains closed? John Calvin professed himself that the only light that could enter into the church was the pure light of God, so we must open wide the curtains and let that pure light of God come in.
Well, that's fine, but it interferes with these projections.
Oh, those are odd. What is with all the instrumentation? The only instruments are the instruments that God gave us himself, the instruments of our own voices. And the only songs we can sing are those songs which God gave us as well, the Psalms. So why would you have drums in church?
That's our praise band. We sing joyfully, and I take issue with John Calvin because the Psalms included the lute, the lyre, cymbals, pipes. So it had instrumental music.
Well, John Knox did change a few things. So where is your pastor?
Oh, Steve?
I'm sorry, what? What did you call him?
Steve. Pastor Steve.
He is your leader. Does he not have a title? Shouldn't he be the Reverend...
Meldy?
Meldy? Isn't that what you should call him? Where is he?
Please stand up, Pastor
oh,
Steve.
Oh, my.
I'm not sure I'm liking where this is going.
What are you wearing? Where is your robe? Your robe, even though it may be warm in this weather, is a symbol of your education. Did you not go to a fine institution like Princeton or Yale?
Princeton.
Princeton, an excellent Presbyterian institution. Where is your robe to prove that?
It's in there.
Where is your robe to set you forth? Education is paramount to us, and we must show our education through your parents, not through casual dress. And what's more, where are your elders?
Why?
Make them arise. Where are your elders?
Elders?
Are your elders not the leaders of this church? Where are your elders? Are your elders shy? There they are. Wait, you have a female elder? Wow, that's new.
Women
come
are
forward.
Women are a part of the leadership of this church and have been for a long time.
That is great. That is much better. Thank you. You, three, only three, you must sit up front and get some chairs. I will let you sit in chairs. Okay. I don't think so. The elders are the leaders of the church. We profess that your leadership is as important as the Reverend Meldy's. And so in my day, the elders remained sitting in the front of the church facing your congregation for the entirety of the service so that we could see your leadership and continue to know who is really in charge. Now there's other problems that I see in this congregation.
What is that?
Your men and women are sitting together.
And casually at
and casually attired. There are no head coverings. And your small children are also sitting with men. All of the women and children should be on this side of the church, and all of the men should be on this side of the church, because we cannot let our hearts be distracted during worship by any canoodling. Our hearts must be purely dedicated to worshiping God.
That's wonderful. But we enjoy the casual seating and fellowship with each other. tell me about why you came and started this church in 1640.
We came across from Scotland in order to have religious freedom. The Presbyterians in Scotland were being persecuted, so we came across for religious freedom, and also because we were dreaming of a better life in this new world, a life where we could own our land, farm it as we want, to grow in this prosperous new world, and to be a part of this new dream.
Thank you. Well, this church also was the first building that you built in this new settlement.
Yes, with its thatched roof.
It's a one-room building, which was multi-purpose.
Yes, we also use it for our school because, again, Presbyterians really value education. We teach even our women and girls how to read and write so that we can read the scriptures for ourselves and interpret them for ourselves. This is something that is not done in the rest of the colonies. We really separate and emphasize education. So we use it during the week for the school, and we also use it for all town hall meetings, and it's okay to mix during those, just not during worship.
Thank you, gentlewoman, for your information on worship practices of the 1600s.
You are welcome.
No,
you must sit there the entire worship.
The importance of the church in the colonies was to join families and to support families. That continues today. That is a major part of our church here. CPC is our family of choice, our community of choice. But we also reach out to those around us in the in Tucson and in the world. And I look forward to your continuing support in 2020 so that we may continue our mission of community. Thank you.
Oh, sure. You're going back, but I'm still wearing a robe?
Take it off.
Take it off. No, you never get to see me in a robe. Why not? The offerings that we have are a part of what allows us to do the ministry, the mission that we do all year long. And I so appreciate that. This morning, the youth group is doing something a little different and a little creative, and they're up in Sabino Canyon, and they're doing a worship experience and a learning experience and a communion experience up in Sabino Canyon this morning. So thank you for making all of that possible for places where people gather here and where people learn to go out into their regular kinds of lives and discover the presence of God and worship God. Let's pray and bless our offering. Gracious, holy, and generous God, thank you for this church and for those from the 1600s who made all of this happen. We're grateful for their history. We're grateful for some of the things we've let go of. And yet we're grateful for the foundation they gave us of trusting in you. May we create that foundation for people yet to be. So may these offerings bless the ministry and the mission of this church so that we can continue into the future proclaiming who you are in Jesus the Christ. Amen.
Yeah.
the lectionary resource for the month of October is the second letter to Timothy in the New Testament. Kind of works out perfectly with all that we're doing in stewardship. Timothy and Titus are books in the New Testament that are called pastoral letters. They're written by the Apostle Paul to two very important individuals, Timothy and Titus. Timothy gets two books because actually Timothy becomes a pretty major leader in the Christian movement under Paul. And Paul and Timothy have a very special relationship, almost a father-son kind of relationship. And Timothy just falls in love with God through Jesus the Christ, as Paul had done, remember, on that road to Damascus when his life changed so dramatically. Remember, Paul was also known as Saul. He was born of mixed parents, one being Jewish, one being Roman. So his Roman name was Paul. His Jewish name was Saul. And most of the time, he claimed his Jewish roots, and so went a lot by Saul until he had that huge conversion experience on the way to Damascus and met the risen Christ. And in that experience, Saul decided that what God in Christ was calling him to do was to preach the gospel to people beyond the Jewish tradition, beyond the tradition in which Jesus had been raised, beyond the scope of what Jesus had proclaimed there in Israel, to all of those non-Jews, to the Romans. And so he claimed his Roman name to sort of come alongside them and to share his kinship with them. As a part of that, he traveled extensively, and on one of his journeys met several people and converted them. Some of them were Lois and Eunice, the ancestors of Timothy, the grandmother and the mother of Timothy. At the time that Paul writes the letters to Timothy, what's happening is Timothy is over in one area of a country working and continuing in the ministry, while Paul is actually over in Rome in jail because he's been sharing the word of God in Jesus the Christ. Remember that we proclaim Jesus as the Son of God. Remember that the Roman emperor at the time of Jesus' birth declared his father divine, God, which made that current Roman emperor who? The Son of God. And any sons he had, therefore, the sons of God. And so when you come along and you have this little family that moves from Nazareth down to Bethlehem because of the census calling, and this new baby is born, and you call this new baby the Son of God, he's in direct competition with the Roman emperor. And please remember that Rome was in charge of this entire territory. So they saw Jesus as a threat, and they saw anybody who followed his way as a threat to Rome. And so Paul found himself scattering through different countries and captured by Rome for proclaiming Jesus to be the Son of God. And so they imprisoned him and most of the time treated him horribly. So he writes back letters to Timothy and Titus, and particularly Timothy, to encourage them because Christians were facing a great deal of persecution at the time. And so these letters are a whole part of that. So let's read from 2 Timothy. Today, we're going to be in the first chapter in the first 14 verses. So Paul writes to Timothy saying, Paul, an apostle of Christ Jesus by the will of God, for the sake of the promise of life that is in Christ Jesus, to Timothy, my beloved child, grace, mercy, and peace from God the Father and Christ Jesus our Lord. I am grateful to God, whom I worship with a clear conscience, as my ancestors did, when I remember you constantly in my prayers, night and day. Recalling your tears, I long to see you so that I may be filled with joy. I am reminded of your sincere faith, a faith that lived first in your grandmother Lois and your mother Eunice, and now, I am sure, lives in you. For this reason, I remind you to rekindle the gift of God that is within you through the laying on of my hands. For God did not give us a spirit of cowardice, but rather a spirit of power and of love and of self-discipline. Don't be ashamed, then, of the testimony about our Lord or of me, his prisoner. but join with me in suffering for the gospel, relying on the power of God who saved us and called us with a holy calling, not according to our works, but according to his own purpose and grace. This grace was given to us in Christ Jesus before the ages began, but has now been revealed through the appearing of our Savior Christ Jesus, who abolished death and brought life and immortality to light through the gospel. For this gospel, I was appointed a herald and an apostle and a teacher. And for this reason, I suffer as I do. But I'm not ashamed, for I know the one in whom I have put my trust, and I am sure that he is able to guard until that day when I have entered and entrusted to him. Hold to the standard of sound teaching that you have heard from me, in the faith and love that are in Christ Jesus, and guard the good treasure entrusted to you with the help of the Holy Spirit living within us. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Arlie Lula Castle. God, all of my brothers and sisters are so grateful we were not named for my grandmother. That was my mom's mom. She was born Arlie, A-R-L-I-E, Arlie Lula Castle. She married William Neal, became Arlie Lula Neal. My paternal grandmother, my dad's mom, was Mary Elizabeth Schuler. She was a good German Catholic woman. My other grandmother was a good Welsh, English Protestant. Wow. What grandmothers I had. Dolores May Neal was my mom. By the age of 10, both of my grandfathers had passed away. And so I didn't really come to know them all that well, or come to know their faith all that well. But I came to know the faith through my grandmothers and my mother and my father. They passed that on to me. They gifted it to me by living, by causing me to go to church, which wasn't always what I wanted to do. Sunday mornings would have been nice to have slept in, to relax a little bit, because Saturdays we weren't allowed to sleep in. Saturdays were work days around the house. Mow the lawn, clean the pool, clean the house, do all of that other kind of stuff that had to be done. And we had to be up and have that done before we could watch American Bandstand or Tarzan. We didn't watch Soul Train. This family didn't watch Soul Train, sorry. So Sunday would have been nice to have slept in, but at 7 o'clock, the TV in my parents' room, the TV in the family room, which were the only two TVs in the entire house, were turned up full blast, and all the Christian worship stations were on. Sunday was for worshiping God, for being together as a family, and celebrating the ancestry of our faith and our life together. All day. All day. And I give thanks for that now. Because there are so many other distractions in our lives that we've allowed in that challenge us to be together and challenge us to share our faith. But my grandparents and my parents shared it boldly and openly. And they grew up in the times in the 50s and the 60s when a lot of people just simply went to church. It's what you did. It's what Sunday was for. There were laws against stores being open. There were laws against selling liquor. There were all of those kinds of things that forced people to simply take that Sabbath time to be with God and to be with one another. And all of those have changed now, right? So it's more difficult. But I give thanks for those ancestors because they taught me the value of loving God and sharing that value with my own family. I hope someday that perhaps my grandchildren will look back at us as grandparents and understand the faith that is deep in us and claim it as their own. I'm hoping that our great-great-great-great-great-great-great-great-grandchildren might hear of us at some point in their lives. Because quite frankly, I absolutely love God. I think God's amazing. And to know that God loves me so deeply just constantly changes my life. The Apostle Paul faced huge persecutions in his life. Just for telling people that very fact that he loved God and he understood who God was through Jesus as God's Son, as Emmanuel, God with us, as his Lord and Savior, put him in jail. Just for saying that. Today we can say it in this town, in this country, anywhere we really want to say it. And sadly, I think the only persecution we have in our lives is the embarrassment we feel by saying it. Not many of us go to the grocery store and tell the clerk, I love Jesus. A lot of us go to the gym and we say, oh God, but we're not talking about God. The only persecution you and I are facing these days is being embarrassed about talking about God. Really? Embarrassed about sharing the greatest story that humanity has ever known? The God, the creator of the entire creation, all universes beyond what you and I could know, loves us so much that God decided to come and be with us to show us how to love. And when we rejected that completely, loved us still. We find that embarrassing? Paul says to Timothy, don't be ashamed. Don't be ashamed of the testimony that's made me a prisoner. Your grandmother, your mother, I, we've all shared this with you, Timothy. Now it's your job. It's your faith. And you got to share it. And you got to move beyond any fear of any persecution in your life. Because this is an amazing story that we've been given. And we've been given it today in our own lives and in the life of this church. And not for a moment need we be afraid of being ashamed of sharing that story. And so the challenge is for us moving into the future to continue to do so and find deeper and greater ways to tell the world what we know and what we believe. So that just perhaps in their lives, the Spirit might draw them to God in Christ as we are drawn. And maybe then our great, 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 great descendants might say of us in the year 2020, remember those people? They gave us the faith. I think that'd be pretty awesome. Thank you, Eunice. Thank you, Lois. Thank you, Arlie. Thank you, Mame. Thank you, Chris and Dee. Make sure you say thank you to your grandparents. Make sure you become thank-you-able. Amen. Amen. We get to come to a table. A table that has been set for us by the grace of God in Jesus the Christ. All y'all are welcome. Any age, any background, those who might be new to the faith today, those who've been in it for years, those who are young, those who are realizing that they're not as young as they thought they were. We're all welcome at this table. Here we share in the story of the life, the death, the resurrection of Jesus the Christ. So come. And let's be at the table. Let's pray together. Gracious and holy God, thank you for all those who've gone before. Particularly those people of this Christian faith who are bold enough to share it that we might hear of it and live it ourselves. Who weren't ashamed and weren't scared to tell the story. Help us to find those places and those people that you lead before us and to not be afraid of sharing our part in the story and our belief in you through Jesus the Christ, no matter what the reaction might be. Because you're amazing. And your loving care for us is humbling. Through your Spirit, work a way within us today that as we come to this table, we will feel your presence in the bread, in the juice, taking you so deeply into our lives that everything about our lives will be about you and the sharing of who you are in Jesus the Christ. For it's in his name that we come together, and through him that we come to you, singing even the prayer that he gave us. Our communion servers to come join me at the table. All are welcome here. None of us fully understand what that meal was all about, but as Jesus gathered with his disciples one night as they were celebrating the Passover, he took the bread that was before them. He blessed it, giving God thanks for it. He broke it open and he said, "This is my body, broken for you." As they were finishing the meal together, he took the cup before them. Pouring it out, he said, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood shed for the forgiveness of sin. All of you drink from it." And his followers did. They ate of the bread, they drank of the cup, not knowing really what he was talking about. Thinking that simply putting their trust in him was going to make everything okay and wonderful and great. And it led them through some very difficult times in their lives. The eating and drinking together gave them the hope that someday God would make it all okay and it all come together. And until then, they knew in these elements the presence of God within them and the courage they had to face whatever they had to face. These are the gifts of the God for the people of God.
You are my portion. You are my portion.
pray together. God, you are our portion. The funny thing is, you don't just give us a part, just a little piece of yourself. You've given us your whole self in Jesus the Christ. And in thanks, we tend to give you just a part of ourselves. When in fact, we really would like to give you our whole selves. We need your help to do so. So we give you our whole lives, behind us and in front of us, to work away, so that our living is all about your loving. Amen.
Please stand.
God forgave my sin in Jesus' name. I've been born again in Jesus' name.
I get to wear a fancy robe to show the world I have a master's degree from Princeton Seminary. In reality, God just calls each of us to be who we are. To celebrate that part of the faith that's in us. You don't have to have a degree to do that. You just have to set your fears aside, not be ashamed of the gospel, and share the truth that God loves us so much. He calls us to love too. Don't be afraid. And share the gospel, will you?
Can't buy me love. Love me too. I may not have a lot to give, but what I got, I'll give to you. 'Cause I don't care too much. just can't buy. Well, I don't care too much for money. Money can't buy me love. Just can't buy. Well, I don't care too much for money. Money can't buy me love. Can't buy me love. Love. Love.
But it can buy lots of things for church.